Now let's turn to an underlying phenomenon that explains part of the patterns of Mendelian genetics, and that's called dominance. Dominance is the ability of a single allele to determine the phenotype of the heterozygote. If there's complete dominance, the heterozygote looks the same, that is, it has the same phenotype as the homozygote for the dominant allele. As it turns out, all the traits that Mendel studied, pea pod shape, color, colors of the peas themselves, these showed complete dominance. So the heterozygotes look the same as the homozygote with the dominant allele. Not all traits show complete dominance. Others show what's called incomplete dominance. And this is where the heterozygote has an intermediate phenotype between the two homozygotes. So let's look at snapdragons. A homozygote with a red allele has red flowers, so those are red snapdragons. Homozygote for the white allele are white, but the intermediates are pink. So if we take a white snapdragon and a red snapdragon, they're both homozygotes for the different alleles, all their offspring will be heterozygotes and they'll all be pink. Then if we cross two of these heterozygotes, we'll get an F2 with three different phenotypes because they have three different genotypes. We'll get red again. So 1 in 4 will be red, 1 in 4 will be white, and the other half will all be pink. They'll be heterozygotes. So we put this in our Punnett square. Each heterozygote, half of its gametes will be capital R, the other half little r, and that's mated with another individual that's the same. Then 1 in 4 will be double dominant, or they'll be homozygotes for the capital R allele, they'll be red. 1 in 4 will be homozygote with a little r allele. And there's two ways to be heterozygote, with red, say, from the dad, white from the mom, and vice versa. So half of the offspring will be pink. So in this case, the phenotypes indicate genotype because there's only incomplete dominance. Now, why do we have some characters that show complete dominance, the others show incomplete dominance? Well, the details are probably too much for an introductory course, and let me just simplify by saying that in the cases of complete dominance, those likely reflect genes that code for proteins called enzymes. And enzymes kind of facilitate reactions and the manufacture of other compounds. And so even a small amount of the enzyme would be sufficient to serve the role as a catalyst to synthesize a more complex protein. On the other hand, with incomplete dominance, genes often code directly for pigments. Pigments can be proteins. And so the more pigment, the stronger the color. So if we have a heterozygote versus a homozygote with incomplete dominance, if you're only getting a single dose, then you're going to be pink. But if you get a double dose, you'll be red. So if we put these two together like this, then twice as much pigment makes for a darker red in the case of the snapdragons. In humans, there are a number of single traits that likewise behave in a Mendelian manner, even so far as to have complete dominance. Here's just a couple. First is whether you have a widow's peak. If you move back the front of your hair on your forehead, some people have a V-shaped patch, and that's a widow's peak. Some people don't have it. Now, if we look at this particular family, we're going to follow the pedigree of a particular trait that's dominant. So a heterozygote will have a widow's peak. So this set of grandparents, one had a widow's peak, the other didn't. Likewise, the other set of grandparents, one had a widow's peak and the other didn't. So the two families then had children, some with widow peak, some without. Okay, and so then two of the parental generation here who had widow's peaks had children, and one of them still has at least one copy of the capital W allele for the widow's peak, whereas the other was recessive and didn't have the widow's peak, okay? Now, we don't know if this individual here is homozygote for that particular trait or if she's heterozygote, because both of her parents had widow's peak. She might be either. And we won't know until she actually has a family of herself, her own. Now, in this trait, let's look at your earlobes. Now, I have an attached earlobe, and that's a recessive trait. More commonly is to see a free earlobe, an earlobe that hangs down, and that's a dominant trait. And this one, let's just track the history then of this recessive trait. So out of these four grandparents for these two sisters, only one had attached earlobes. The other three had free earlobes. Well, in the next generation, we see that it reappears. There's some with attached earlobes, some without. So that means these grandparents had to be heterozygotes in order for them to have children that both had an attached earlobe and other children that had a free earlobe. So then we have two heterozygotes here. Okay, that means they both would have had free earlobes. And one of them is now a recessive, has an attached earlobe. And the other, again, we don't know if it's homozygous for the free earlobe or whether it's another heterozygote, but they have different phenotypes. So the simple Mendelian genetics, we're tracking through one generation after the other, and we see the reappearance of these traits coming and going because there's complete dominance with a single locus trait. So those are the easiest ones to talk about in class. Some of the traits that we might find more interesting, like the color of your eyes, hair color, and your height, these likewise are genetic, but they show much more complex forms of inheritance, as I'll outline in a minute.